Fisher. I work with JVP of Northern New Jersey. And I have to tell you three things. It's cold in here. We're sorry about that, but it is getting warmer, slowly but surely. Second thing, we don't have a microphone that works. I don't think that'll be a problem for too many people, except maybe for me, because I have no voice. So yell at me if I should be speaking louder. And yeah, we're all set to start. So I want to begin by introducing our wonderful Alice Golan, who will tell you a little bit about our chapter.
Hi, I'm Alice Golan, and I'm the lady that you get emails from if you are already on our email list, and who will be getting them from me in the future if you've just signed up for our email list. 2.5 years ago, we formed the Northern New Jersey chapter of Jewish Voice for Peace, and we have grown tremendously since then. And I have to say, this is very exciting. This is the first event we have had where we have had to put out extra chairs. Jewish Voice for Peace is a national member-driven organization dedicated to U.S. national and foreign policy based on peace, human rights, and respect for international law. We work for justice, equality, and dignity for all in Israel and Palestine. So that's kind of what Jewish Voice for Peace nationally stands for and what our local organization stands for. In the 2.5 years that we've been in existence, we have done a lot of things, and I was really amazed when I looked at the list this morning. We have formed numerous coalitions with Muslim and local peace groups. We've established an ongoing relationship with the Palestinian American Community Center in Clifton, and actually in March we will be hosting a potluck and film showing with them, and you will all be getting invitations to that. We've demonstrated in support of the Gaza March and against Trump's travel ban. We held training on how to intervene if you see someone being harassed because of their ethnic, religious, or racial identity. We've hosted a film and other panel discussions and a speaker on BDS and another on Israel's nation state bill. Several of us have met with representatives from Senator Booker and Senator Menendez's office about what is happening in Gaza and to ask them, not very successfully, to not sponsor the BDS bill, which is currently before Congress. So I hope you've all signed our list, and please come to future events, and you'll be hearing from me if you would like to become more active in our chapter. Thank you.
We are very delighted that Democratic Socialists of America are co-sponsoring this event today. And so I'd like to introduce Craig Spivak, who will give you a little rundown on what they've been doing.
Hi, everyone. My name is Craig Spivak. I'm a member of Jewish Voice for Peace, and I'm also one of the co-chairs of the Hudson County branch of North New Jersey Democratic Socialists of America. Democratic Socialists of America is the largest socialist organization in the country. We had around 6,000 members at the beginning of 2016, and we've grown so rapidly that we now have over 55,000 members across the country. Locally, we've been working pretty heavily on migrant justice, fighting contracts that local governments have with immigration and customs enforcement. And we've also been working on housing justice, doing anti-eviction work, and helping people fight back against eviction. As socialists, we strongly believe in equality, and that doesn't stop at the border. So last year at our national convention, we endorse with full support the call for boycott, divestment, and sanctions. We oppose apartheid, and we want full equality for all Palestinians. and we're excited to be bringing that national resolution to the local level and to get started organizing locally, and we're really excited to be co-hosting this event with Jewish Voice for Peace. Thank you.
And they're young. Let me tell you very briefly, 2 minutes, why we're here today, why we felt it was important to hold this event. For 7 decades, the state of Israel has been oppressing Palestinians, dispossessing them, occupying their land, blockading them, discriminating against them. Over the years, many people of goodwill, Jews and non-Jews alike, have sought nonviolent ways to support the Palestinian people in their struggle for justice and freedom. One of the strategies being used to get Israel to change its policies is called BDS, Boycott, Divestment, Sanction. These are tactics that have been applied often in the past by social justice advocates against the forces of oppression, most notably by the civil rights movement here in the United States and in the campaign against apartheid in South Africa. Those who continue to defend Israel's policies and actions toward Palestinians have found themselves more and more often on the losing side of this debate. It's a hard sell to convince people, including Jews, that, for example, unleashing snipers on unarmed protesters is somehow justifiable. So Israel's apologists have again dragged out that unconscionable attack tactic of accusing pro-Palestinian activists and BDS supporters of anti-Semitism. This charge is a powerful and ugly weapon. And no, support for Palestine in no way suggests anti-Semitism. Nor are those of us who are pro-Palestinian Jews self-hating. So, what are the facts? What is the relationship between BDS, Israel, and anti-Semitism? Our program this afternoon will explore these questions, first with talks by our three panelists, and then through discussions with you, our audience members. So we can get started. I'm delighted to introduce our first presenter, Ahmad Awad. Ahmad is a lifelong New Jersey resident who received his BA in history from Fordham University in New York City. While there, he attempted to establish a chapter of Students for Justice in Palestine. But Fordham refused to allow this organization to be formed, and Ahmad led a lawsuit against the university, claiming violations of its own guidelines, as well as viewpoint discrimination. Ahmad is currently a second year JD candidate at Rutgers Law School in Newark.
Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to first thank Jews Voice for Peace for having me here today. I would also like to say a happy Hanukkah to all those in the room that are celebrating. I would like to start with a just simple discussion on what the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions movement is. So the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions movement looks to use nonviolent means to pressure the Israeli government to meet its obligations under international law and its occupation of Palestinian lands, as well as full equality for the Arab Palestinian citizens of Israel. The reason why I am so engulfed into this situation and support for the BDS movement and overall support for Palestinian human rights is my two histories of oppression that I grew up with taught me to value human dignity and fight injustice wherever I see it. My father's side of the family are Palestinians who were born in the West Bank prior to the establishment of Israel, and my mother's parents were survivors of Nazi occupation during the Second World War. They were Polish Catholics. My grandfather was a survivor of Nazi labor camps. I saw what inhumane and injustice does to people. I seen him be dispossessed of his homeland. He never returned back to Poland. He was put into displaced persons camps and eventually migrated to the United States, where he set up his life, had a family, and lived here, where he continues to live to this day. When the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement first started, I thought this is a phenomenal way to really bring attention to the Palestinian cause. Notably, because I saw what had happened in South Africa and what had happened around the world, even here in the United States. And specifically, once I learned more about the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement, I decided that it's more important to understand how it applies to us here as Americans in the United States. Because of my advocation for the BDS movement, I've had a lot of critics claim that I'm anti-Semitic, I'm hating towards the Jewish people, which is completely false. A number of my friends, my closest friends, are Jewish Americans. I have no hatred or disregard for Jewish life. I have no hatred or disregard for any human life. I simply am looking to allow for Palestinians to have the same rights of equality and the same rights of life that others around the world are able to have. To begin with, I would like to first speak on why the BDS movement is necessary. Soon after the establishment of the State of Israel, after which 700,000 plus Palestinians were expelled from their lands, the Israeli government began to enact numerous laws which would limit the rights of Palestinians that resided in Israel, as well as those who lived in the occupied territories after 1967. To this day, there are more than 65 Israeli laws that exist that discriminate against Palestinians in Israel and the occupied territories. For example, 93% of land in Israel is public and belongs to the state, the Jewish National Fund, and the Development Authority. Arab Palestinian citizens of Israel are blocked from leasing 80% of that land. In 1950, the absentee property law called that Palestinians expelled after November 29, 1947 are absentees, were denied rights to their land, their houses, homes, any property, as well as their bank accounts were confiscated, and they had absolutely no right to it. After 1967, the Israeli government began to crack down on Palestinians who lived in East Jerusalem. Since 1967, 15,000 Palestinians from East Jerusalem have had their residency rights revoked and have been forcibly removed from East Jerusalem. Seeing these laws continue to happen, and it's not that they just continue to happen in the past, it's that they continue to happen now, as you can see with the current nation-state law that was just passed, which minimizes the importance of the Palestinian history in Israel, which it also downgrades Arabic to a special status rather than an official language when Israel's population, 20% of it is Arab. Seeing all these injustice and all these laws being passed shows that what are the options? If you go down a violent route, you see what happens. It's impossible to have justice in a violent route. So I began to do a history on how the boycott movement helped in the United States. And in the United States, since the creation of the United States, in the 1760s and 1770s, American colonists, no matter who they were, whether they were from a low socioeconomic class upwards of being very high and wealthy American colonists, they used boycott as a way to crack down on the British rule over the colonies. Prior to the Civil War, abolitionists boycotted goods produced that were used with slave labor. In the 1930s, the American Jewish Congress boycotted Nazi Germany for its discrimination and its hatred towards the Jewish community. In the 1950s and 1960s, the civil rights boycotts, specifically the Montgomery bus boycott, which lasted 381 days, had an estimated 40,000 participants, which was the amount of 75% of the bus riders in Montgomery at the time, brought extreme change to that area and was able to establish a civil rights case that called the discrimination and segregation on buses as unequal and unconstitutional. Seeing how the boycott movement in our history was able to bring such change had me believe that that is the means for my people, for my Palestinian people, to accomplish the same peace that African Americans and Jewish Americans in the civil rights movement looked for, their own equality. Up until today, BDS gets a lot of hatred for being anti-Jewish and anti-Semitic. This is far from the truth. The American Jewish community is strongly behind the BDS movement. They have specifically numerous American Jewish civil rights activists who advocated for basic rights during the civil rights movement, encouraged this route. They know that this worked. They know that they were able to accomplish extreme change here in the United States at a time when it didn't seem like it was even possible. And during this time, it was common for those who would boycott against these inequality for African Americans to be labeled as anti-American and to be labeled as haters of American society. And as we can see now, 50, 60 years from this, that there was extreme change that was able to be accomplished. And it was because of those movements that African Americans were able to have the rights that they have to this day. I'm going to quote now Desmond Tutu, who stated that, "In South Africa, we could not have achieved our democracy without the help of people around the world who, through the use of nonviolent means, such as boycott and divestment, encourage their governments and other corporate actors to reverse decades-long support for the apartheid regime." It's obvious that the best way to impact change is to hit people's pockets. When companies start to realize that if they begin to help and begin to support a lot of these oppression around the world, no matter where it exists, that they will start to lose business. They'll realize what they're doing is not right, that they are also supporting injustice. And I believe that with that type of change and with the boycott and divestment sanctions movement, there could be real, real change for the Palestinians within Israel as well as those who reside in the occupied territories. Now moving away from the boycott movement, but still talking about it, is that in the United States, there's been a lot of crackdown here, even amongst the left wing and right wing, on the boycott movement for calling that the boycott movement is anti-Semitic. There are numbers of laws around the country that are being passed by legislators with bipartisan support that are asking for people who boycott Israel to have repercussions for their actions. I was just reading about a case in Kansas where a public school teacher, Esther Kuntz, decided that she wanted to complete a Kansas State Department of Education training program to qualify her to make some extra money by leading professional development sessions for the state's math and science teachers. After she completed the program, and she was contacted by state officials to, you know, fill out some basic paperwork so that she can receive the qualifications, she was told that she must sign a certification verifying that she won't boycott Israel. She stated that she won't, and they refused to pay her. They said that because of the law in Kansas, they cannot hire someone who boycotts Israel. Kuntz decided to file a lawsuit against this, and in Kuntz v. Watson, the Federal Courts of Appeal in Kansas, for the District of Kansas, granted a preliminary injunction preventing further enforcement of this law. They called this law unconstitutional, and it had absolutely no right to be in existence from the get-go. Seeing that there are courts around the world, around this country, that are starting to realize that although governments and legislators can enforce these laws and can vote to have these laws passed, that does not necessarily mean that they're constitutional. Since the 1960s, in the NAACP v. Claiborne Hardware Company case, the Supreme Court held that the First Amendment protects the right of Americans to participate in boycotts. Throughout the later half of the 20th century, we see that these boycott movements continued throughout the country and had an extreme impact on American society. Without the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement, specifically being a young Palestinian, I don't see much other options. If you have a people who are oppressed, a people who are segregated and discriminated against constantly every single day, what do you expect from them? I go there, I've been to Palestine a number of occasions. I'm an American citizen. I was born to American citizens. I've lived here my entire life. My mother's Polish, my father's Palestinian. Very strong in American politics. I advocate for being an American, because being an American is honestly one of the greatest opportunities here in being a human in this world. But to see Palestinians who have zero to none rights in the occupied territories, and I see them go through a day-to-day with no jobs, or unable to attend schools, or constant imprisonment, or, you know, lack of opportunities throughout their communities, even to the most basic situations where when I'm there and I see there's roads where Jewish settlers can drive, but I'm not allowed to drive on those roads because I'm not Jewish. Seeing these firsthand and being stopped by Israeli occupation forces in the occupied territories has really enraged me. But understanding that there must be a rule of law, I understand how the American Constitution works, and I want to bring that elsewhere around the globe. I honestly, truly believe that the American way of law and justice is the best way that we have in the world. And the only way to bring change is by working with these qualities, these great qualities that the Americans and civil rights activists and colonists and anyone in the United States history have used to bring about extreme change. I think that that's the method for Palestinians as well. Violence doesn't work. We see what happens when violence happens. One side will hit the other side will hit back, and the bystanders on the outside will say it's a conflict, it's a war zone, we can't do anything about it. It's gonna be having to be dealt with amongst themselves. But if we're able to move on a nonviolent means and bring about a boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement against these Israeli government interests, we can show that it's not necessarily just an issue of the region, it's an issue around the world. It will impact not only Israelis, but it will impact the lives of Palestinians. We need to bring change. There will not be any way of accomplishing this change peacefully other than the boycott movement. It's a shame for Americans who, specifically Americans in government, who consider themselves as social justice leaders, to then be on the end of supporting anti-boycott legislation that will endanger the rights of activists such as myself and such as many of you in this room. As you can see, the BDS movement is bringing change, and it's obviously scaring the Israeli government. They're using this tactic of anti-Semitism because they believe that that is their only way that they're going to be able to try to get a niche society to believe their lies. They know that it's an effective method. They know that there is such a large American Jewish community behind the method. Not even American Jewish community, Jewish communities around this world that support the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement. I believe that soon, slowly but surely, just how as it was in the 1960s, how it was wrong to speak out against African-American rights, and it was seen as you are an outsider for advocating for those rights, that soon my children will be able to see that it is okay to advocate for Palestinian rights, that people in our generation today fought for those rights to make it possible for those in the future. As you can see in Kansas, or in specifically last week, how at NYU they passed to support the BDS movement in NYU, which was a complete shock. But it really honestly it shows that the movement is taking off, and it's like wildfire. From where it started, and when I first learned about the movement, I did not know much about it. And it was a small movement amongst the Palestinian groups, and then it slowly started to branch out. And now it's taking such wide stream steam that I honest to God believe that it is going to bring about change. And people who are going against it now will be ridiculed in the future when history writes their judgment. And it's like I said, it's a matter of time. The only thing we can do is be patient. We need to support, we can't stand back. When people stand back and are afraid, nothing will be accomplished. There has to be active support for this. There has to be active support outside of the Palestinian and outside of the Jewish American community. We need to attract attention from countries around the world, communities around the world, from Spanish communities to Asian communities to North European communities. We need to get activists behind this to prove that this is the only route for a justifiable and possible outcome for peace in that region. And I truly believe that with support to this, there will be change, there will be peace inside of Israel, there will be equality of rights for Israeli Arab Palestinian citizens, as well as a solution to the occupation in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. I look forward to speaking with you guys on any questions you may have, and I appreciate you guys having me here today. Thank you.
Michael has been a member of JVP Northern New Jersey since its inception. We're very proud of our relationship with Michael, as he is a brilliant writer. If you have not read his articles, please pick some up on our literature table. In addition to his columns on Israel and Palestine, he is the author of poetry, fiction, nonfiction, and Michael is also a lawyer whose work focuses on abuse and civil rights issues. His most recent book is Sexual Abuse, Shanda, and Concealment in Orthodox Jewish Communities. A book of Michael's poetry will be appearing in early 2020. So a warm welcome to Michael.
A subject that is unpleasant to talk about but concerns many people who speak out about Palestinian rights, and that is the paradox of the American Jewish community, which for the most part is more or less mildly liberal in its political positions, but seems to depart from this standard when the issue of Palestine arises. I want to talk a little bit about why that is, how we got here, and what perhaps we could do about it, or at least what it seems to me we might want to do about it. I'm going to be talking mostly about Jews, because that's the subject matter. You don't have to be Jewish, but this is the subject. After all, the American Jewish community is very much in the front line of the Israeli propaganda efforts, and this is very relevant to what we're talking about. So first of all, I'm going to start, I've said this before, so if anybody's stalking me, your punishment is you get to hear this twice. do you know the difference between a Jewish pessimist and a Jewish optimist? A Jewish pessimist says, things can't get any worse. The Jewish optimist says, yes, they can. So, I'm a Jewish optimist. And, you know, things can get worse. But you have to know that because things can get worse, it means change is in the air. And when change is in the air, a lot of things can happen. Now, where are we? What is this paradox about the way things are going? I can tell you from personal experience, I'm not going to tell you too much of my personal experience, but I can tell you, and most of you here know, it is not easy to speak out about Palestinian rights within the American Jewish community. There's a lot of resistance that you run into when you do. But the first thing that I want to stress here is that there's another side to the story. In many ways, we're much more successful than we've ever been. And I would argue that our side of the argument is more successful today than the side of Israeli propaganda. Yeah. This is not news, you don't have to hear it from me. Peter Beinart has written a book about this, Norman Finkelstein has written a book about this. There is steady, consistent poll data showing that American Jews are drifting away from their support for Israel. This has been going on for a number of years, and it's especially noted among young American Jews, which means their future. And I'm not the first person to notice this. This has been noticed a long time ago by American Jewish organizations and by the Israelis. Now, it so happens that I saw some of this unfolding in real time through a complete quirk, but I'll just mention it to you, so I have to bring myself in to tell this story. Somehow or other, through some vagary of cybernetics, I got onto an email mailing list that was intended for Jewish philanthropists. Well, they got the Jewish part right. But so I'm getting these emails from an organization that deals with Jewish philanthropists, Jewish big donors to organizations. This was years ago. And in newsletter after newsletter, they're writing about this big problem that we're losing Jews for Israel. Jews are not supporting Israel anymore, especially young Jews, and especially on college campuses, and we really need to do something about that. Okay, this is their perspective, not mine. This is what they're writing. Well, these are organizations, they have money, they don't just talk about things, they do it. So they convened a big conference, all these American Jewish organizations got together, they discussed the problem, they all agreed it was a serious problem, they raised a lot of money to address it. I think they raised about $100 million at that time, and then Sheldon Adelson kicked in $50 million of his own. But there's been more under the bridge. So, but anyway, my point is this was years ago. They knew the problem was very real then. And that's the origin of the great new wave that we see today of Israeli propaganda, Stand With Us, the Israel Project, and so on. And we hear a lot from these people. But here's the point I want to make. It was perfectly clear from the blurbs I saw in the newsletter and from the comments that were made by the organizations when all this stuff started, that what they thought they were going to do on college campuses was what they call outreach. They were going to distribute literature. They were going to bring in speakers. They were going to have panel discussions, and they were going to get the message of Israel out to the public. Now, that's not surprising, because that's what they were doing in the 70s when I was in college. How much of that have they done? The answer is almost none. If you look around at what they're doing today, that is hardly even addressed. What they're doing is intimidating the opposition. That is where almost all their effort has gone. Surveilling people, smearing them, distributing information about them to prospective employers, to the government, the Israeli government, trying to make life difficult for them. And you don't have to take my word for it. If you haven't seen it, you really ought to take a look at there's a four-part documentary that Al Jazeera put together, although they suppressed it. It's now available through Electronic Intifada. At least it used to be. Is it still there? You know?
Yes.
I think so. Yeah. I saw it. Anyway, so you ought to go to their website, Electronic Intifada. You can see all four parts of this documentary. If you're familiar with this issue, you're not going to learn anything startlingly new, but it's still remarkable to see these people themselves, the people who run these organizations, most of them quite young, talking about, on a hidden camera, what they do. And you won't hear them talking about outreach. You won't hear them talking about bringing people around to the Israel message. What you hear them talking about is how we're really sticking it to the opposition, how we're really making their lives difficult, really slowing them up, making them respond to personal attacks. That's what they're up to. Now, Jewish optimist that I am, I say that that's good news. We have to see the good news in that. It's not just that they're losing the argument. These people who are very sophisticated, who know this issue very well, know they've lost it already. Okay? As far as the facts are concerned, they've virtually given up the battle. That's not what they're up to. What they are up to is tangling with us. Now, I would argue there are two reasons they're doing that. One is the obvious. They want to shut up the opposition. But there's another reason which I think is perhaps even more fundamental. And that is, knowing that they can't win over undecideds, they are working their level best to hold on to the faithful, to ensure that people who are already on their side are driven to be even more committed, even more fanatical in their defense of the state. And, equally important, to prevent people who are undecided, who might start thinking that there's somewhere else to look, they want to make sure that when those people start looking around, the first thing they hear about every critic of Israel is what?
Anti-Semite,
right? Accused of anti-Semitism, associated with Louis Farrakhan, associated with Holocaust denial. Because for many people, that's all it takes. And they know. So that's their effort now. It means, so we see that with all their money, with all this war chest they've got to work on, they're not winning over undecided votes, but they are trying to hold on to the faithful. And what we have to understand is how those arguments work and perhaps what we can do about them. Now, I don't want to bore you with war stories about me, but I just want to read you just a few typical comments of things that have been printed publicly about my columns, just because I think it's illustrative of what's going on, and both in what they say and what they don't say. Here are just a couple. This is someone writing about a column I wrote. No, this is not a free speech issue. This is a blood libel published by a self-hating Jew who simply has no right to call himself observant. Mind you, the person doesn't know me from Adam. Okay? Another one. Lesher calls himself an observant Jew. He is not. I doubt any Orthodox Jew in New Jersey allows him to enter. There are too many Jews like Lesher who masquerade as Jews. Then this one thought he would address me personally. Michael, if you were truly an Orthodox Jew, you would not slander Israel. I was thinking of writing back to him, asking him for a citation for that. Where does it say in Shulchan Aruch? Here's another one. I really like this one. The Palestinians do not deserve a state. They would commit genocide against the Jews, or at least try their level. But now blah, 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 it goes on like that. Then it says, you actually know this already. So stop being a narcissist on this matter. You only facilitate more dead Jews. So here's my point. First of all, notice what they don't say. Right? And I haven't chosen. I did a little cherry picking to leave out the ones laced with obscenities, which is maybe half of them. But the point is, this is very typical. There's no response here to anything factual that I wrote. There's no argument. What kind of argument would you say this is? It's all about me. I'm no good. I'm not really Jewish. I'm not Orthodox. I want to kill people. I want to kill Jews. That's what this is about. And again, the reason is they're echoing what they hear from the Israel lobby. And what the Israel lobby wants you to hear, whenever you hear about a critic of Israel, is this is about anti-Semitism. Now, again, this is news. It wasn't always like this. And just so I can leave myself out of this, how many of you heard about this new CNN poll? Okay, I don't get too much into it, they didn't hear about it. But I mean, they get 7,000 respondents in 7 European countries, and they claim that based on this, 1 out of 4 Europeans is an anti-Semite. It's absolute nonsense, but it gets better, because the Israeli lobby immediately seized on this. And all through the Israeli press you can read today that this is why Airbnb stopped listing locations in settlements in occupied Palestine. Now, you can't make this stuff up, right? I mean, whatever Airbnb's motive, they're pretty transparent what their motive was. They're pressured by people who pointed out that this is in violation of international law, right? All 15 judges of the ICJ 2004 ruled that every Israeli settlement is illegal under international law. Some people objected to that, so Airbnb said, hey, you objected, we won't advertise. What's this got to do with anti-Semitism in Europe and a CNN poll? But that's what they want you to hear. That's the point. They're concerned. They don't want organizations like Airbnb dropping settlements, because people read about that in the Washington Post and the New York Times, and they think, gosh, maybe there's a reason for this. So they want you. What's the reason they want you to hear? Anti-Semitism. That's it. That's all the logic that goes into this. Now, is there anything we can do about this? Well, I think so. There are a couple of things. And here's what I try to do. When I'm not preaching, I'm just going to give you a couple of ideas, and you can take it or leave it, and you can ask me more questions when that time comes around. Here's what I think. If you're going to raise these discussions, a couple of things that seem to make sense to me. Number one, the critics, the people I'm arguing against, they don't want to talk about facts. I want to talk about facts. I want to talk fact, fact, fact. I want to talk about that, and I want to make them respond on the same line. And the other thing I like to do is, because they like to challenge me, I want to challenge them. My argument is, this is what's happened, okay? Israel's practicing apartheid. Israeli forces are killing unarmed demonstrators. They're murdering children. They're murdering medics. They're murdering journalists. You know this. You're not disputing the facts. So tell me, do you support this or don't you? If you support it, what's your excuse? If you don't, what are you doing about it? Now, I would love to tell you that every time I pull this, I have people running to me and ready to join the Jewish Voice for Peace. It's not happening. In fact, I almost never get an answer at all. And again, I think that's good news. If people aren't answering, that means they have to start thinking. If they had an answer, they'd be giving it to me. They don't have an answer, so they gotta think. Now, the second thing that I think one needs to do on this issue, and this is a little harder, but it's important. You have to ask yourself, again, you don't have to do this, but if you're engaged in discussion with people of this kind, you have to think to yourself, why does this propaganda work with them? And it works for a very simple reason. Jews are afraid of anti-Semitism. Okay, we are. We have reason to be. And we've seen this. We see it again. We just saw it just recently. We just saw this current, again, Tempest at a teapot about, what was his name, Lamont Hill. So, you know, when I hear the words Palestine should be free, I don't hear a threat in that. But some people do. And the reason they do, or the reason they can be made to, is that 80 years ago, let's say, people were speaking loudly in public meetings about how they want to be free of the Jews. They need to be free of Jewish influence, free of the Jewish conspiracies. They weren't speaking on behalf of an oppressed minority. They were attacking an oppressed minority. And what they meant was they wanted to be free of our existence. And Jews know that. They remember that. And if you can push that button, you can make people respond. And that's what these people are up to. That's their goal. So what I try to do is to understand that and turn it around. You know, there were a couple of numbers in that CNN poll that I thought were kind of interesting. What did they show actual people reporting unfavorable attitudes towards Jews? 10%. 10% in Europe, and that includes Poland and Hungary. In my view, this is not a crisis. This is pretty good news. But 37% report unfavorable attitudes toward Muslims. 36% unfavorable attitudes toward immigrants. That's where the trouble's brewing. Okay? This is real, serious, potentially virulent xenophobia that's brewing through the world. And it's not innocent here in this country, too. You're starting to see it here. I mean, the idea of sending troops down to the border, you know, for a few hundred wretched people trying to get asylum, that's, I mean, this happens for a reason. Now, the poll showed something interesting which didn't get reported in the press, but it should have been looked at more closely. If you had an unfavorable attitude toward Israel, the poll showed, you were more likely to have an unfavorable attitude toward Muslims. In fact, this was surprising to me, but 51%, I think, over half of the respondents who had an unfavorable attitude toward Muslims favored Palestine over Israel in the Israel-Palestine conflict. Okay? But that's not what we're told, right? We're told that this is a battle between the Muslims and the West and this sort of thing. But what these figures suggest is something different. I can't get inside the heads of the respondents, but I would theorize this. Again, what we're seeing is xenophobia, nativism, right-wing populism, very dangerous brew, as we all know. That's driving everything else. And if you're that kind of bigot, and you're really upset about Muslim immigrants coming to your country, what do you think about Palestinians? Well, they want a state in the Mideast. So these bigots are saying to themselves, "Hear, hear. Give them a state in the Mideast so they don't come to my country." And if Israel is not allowing them to have that state, they're no friend of Israel either. So what I want to say is, this is, if you're worried about anti-Semitism, let's put the moral issue aside, not that I minimize it, but practical purposes, just setting aside the moral question, just as a matter of practical self-interest, in my view, the whole Jewish community should be standing shoulder to shoulder with these refugees. The whole Jewish community should be standing shoulder to shoulder with Muslims. Because if there's going to be an outbreak of bigotry that hurts minorities, that's where it's going to start. But it's not going to stop there. Not only will it spread naturally to Jews because Jews are going to be among the outsiders in the eyes of the nativists and so on. But the more they see Israel feeding the problem, the more they see Israel attacking Syria, attacking Lebanon, threatening to attack Iran, repressing the Palestinian national movement, the more they're going to start saying, well, you know, they're making things worse for us. Worried about anti-Semitism, worry about this. This is what I say to people. You don't like religious discrimination? Israel practices religious discrimination. You don't like discrimination against Jews? Israel's been discriminating against Jews from Arab countries since its earliest years. You worry about xenophobia? Right, you should. But also worry about who's feeding that fear, who's making it worse every day. And these are arguments, I think, that perhaps, in time, can sway people so that we start to get people to listen to this. And that's important because, look, we face difficulty speaking out for Palestinian rights. I can tell you as a member of the Orthodox Jewish community, it is not easy. But if we persist, we can be an important part of a genuinely historic movement. And that's something that we shouldn't shirk. All right, thank you.
help implement racial and ethnic justice. Alana.
Muslim, Christian, and Jewish leaders traveling to Israel-Palestine as part of a human rights delegation to meet with Palestinian and Israeli activists. Before even boarding the plane in Washington, D.C., we were told that the airline had received direction from Israeli immigration and that without a letter from the Israeli consulate saying otherwise, we were not allowed to travel. This was the first implementation of the BDS activist ban, a law passed in the Israeli Knesset barring leaders of groups supporting economic pressure to challenge Israeli policies. The BDS activist ban was passed and implemented because of the collective truth-telling of our movements that the state of Israel has been built upon the oppression and dispossession of Palestinians. As we jumped into action mode, figuring out how to respond, taking photos for Facebook, recording our stories and talking points, I will say that I was reeling a little bit and a bit shocked. And at the same time, I also was not surprised. The implementation of the BDS activist ban and the barring of political activists is a reflection of the intense crackdowns of dissent that have been happening within Israeli society. And this enforcement of borders to keep out political dissent is a refraction of the experience of so many Palestinians attempting to navigate an apartheid system every day. The violence of borders and restrictions on freedom of movement, which is a restriction on dignity, a restriction on family, a restriction on home, has been a defining factor of the lives of Palestinians living in East Jerusalem, in the West Bank, in Gaza, and in the diaspora. The BDS activist ban is an additional layer of political repression layered on top of this current system of apartheid, which bars Palestinians from traveling to Israel, sometimes for their political actions and sometimes just for being Palestinian. The implementation of the BDS activist ban to bar a multi-faith group, which included myself, two other Jews, a rabbi, a Christian leader in the Presbyterian Church, and a Muslim Palestinian leader, also clarified that Israel is not even, as it claims, a state for Jewish people. It is, in fact, a state only for people who are not dissenting from the status quo of apartheid. I think we can also look at the BDS ban as how it shows the collective power of boycotts and divestment from Palestinian oppression. It shows the power of the Palestinian call for solidarity that was issued in 2005. So we already heard a little bit about it, but I'm going to say a little more. So as a person at my congressional office told me, when I called them about this, they said, well, you know, I've talked to the consulate and they really seem to feel like there's a difference between being a human rights activist and being an economic threat, and I really don't think they're going to change their minds on this one. So we can see that there's a strong power to a movement that's putting economic. So going back to 2005, we heard a little bit about it. On assessing the histories of Palestinian resistance, the further entrenchment of occupation, dispossession, and Israeli aggression, Palestinian civil society made a collective choice to ask for the commitment of solidarity from organizations and people across the globe to lift up Palestinian nonviolent resistance and cultivate economic pressure campaigns wherever we are. This was a collective choice that was built on the collective choices of the African National Congress and Black-led solidarity to utilize economic pressure to build a powerful counterweight to legalized apartheid in South Africa. Anyone in this room, maybe raise your hand, give a little clap or a shake or stomp your feet if you or anyone in your family was part of those efforts. Okay, this collective choice was also of Palestinian society was also built upon the collective choices of farm workers across the last century to bring corporations to cede to their demands for fair pay and working conditions. So again, give me a clap, snap, if you supported farm worker boycotts in any way. So as we know and as we heard, so well, there's a really long history of boycotts being used to further civil rights, human rights, and labor rights struggles. And boycotts are simply tactics, like voting, protesting, writing a letter to the editor. The BDS movement for Palestinian freedom and equality is not defined by these tactics, but by its Palestinian leadership, by its goals, its values, and its strategies. The BDS movement is a rights-based movement utilizing economic pressure to support Palestinian freedom and equality. And because a future that is built on Palestinian rights requires the fulfillment of the three demands that, again, we heard a little bit about, I'm going to say them again, because I think we can really all practice not just saying BDS, but saying BDS movement for Palestinian freedom and equality, and talking about the goals and values of this work. So the goals are an end to occupation, full and equal rights for Palestinian citizens of Israel, and a right to return for Palestinian refugees.
Yes.
So right now,
yes.
Yeah, those are some good goals, right? So right now, currently, Israel is a country with a set of rights only for Jewish Israelis, a reality that has existed for a long time and was concretized through the recent nation state bill. It's a country implementing military law for Palestinian children in the West Bank, while at the same time, civil law for Jewish Israeli settlers. And the vision of BDS is to create pressure to change that and to create equality, dignity, and freedom for Palestinians as well as Israelis. So we're in a moment of some intense contradictions. We are winning BDS campaigns for Palestinian freedom. We've heard about the Stolen Home campaign, which has pressured Airbnb to stop operating in the West Bank. We heard about the huge win at NYU for Students for Justice in Palestine and Jewish Voice for Peace. They passed divestment. The Deadly Exchange campaign, which is working to end US-Israeli police exchanges, had two huge wins. This is all just in the past few weeks, with police chiefs in Massachusetts and Vermont pulling out of these training exchanges for the first time.
And
we all now live in a world where there are two members of the US Congress who are openly supporting BDS.
Yeah.
Maybe in New Jersey soon and in our day, you know, some more work to do. And at the same time, every day, Palestinian rights are eroding, and the entrenched state of apartheid is moving further and further from the goals of our movement. Daily home demolitions, ground broken for new Jewish-only settlements on Palestinian land. But that's exactly the why and the strategy of the Palestinian-led BDS movement. Where our current governments and international bodies are failing, grassroots global movements can shift politics and policy, and we are seeing that. Social movements shift the discourse. If you haven't read the op-ed by Michelle Goldberg in the New York Times about why anti-Semitism is not anti-Zionism, you should read it immediately. You should read it out there, right? This is one huge shift in the discourse that was made possible by our organizing, which can shift the political context and shift what's possible by connecting people, like all of us here, to each other, and amassing our opinions into collective action and political power. This is what's going to create a context where there's more equal power dynamic between Palestinian civil society and the state of Israel, between occupier and occupy. The BDS movement for Palestinian freedom is the precondition for any resolution based on human rights and equality. Jewish Voice for Peace sees our role in getting US policy and unquestioning support of Israel on an international, financial, and military level out of the way. So that's why it is so huge that even as we've seen regressive policies from the embassy move to the anti-free speech, anti-BDS legislation, in these past 2 years, our movement over time has broken the bipartisan consensus, an alignment of basically all Democrats with the Christian right and the Israel lobby, something that APAC took decades to build. So, what's threatening about BDS is that through economic pressure and through truth-telling, we are building a moral pressure with political weight behind it. What's threatening about the BDS movement for Palestinian equality is the vision of a pluralistic democracy, the vision of equality. And that should be illuminated. illuminating. I've chosen, along with all of you, I believe, to be part of a collective vision of a world where Palestinians live in freedom, a world where Jewish Israelis are part of a multi-ethnic, pluralistic democracy, a world where Mizrahi Jews are leading a vision of an Israel-Palestine that is truly part of the Middle East, and a vision that was so threatening to the current state of Israeli occupation and dispossession that they wouldn't let people working to enact it be part of conversations with Palestinian and Israeli human rights organizers and activists. So I think that for those of us whose position in this movement is one of examining our own complicity and our community's complicity, part of why we do this work, part of what we're offering in our organizing is telling the truth, and that telling the truth is liberating. I believe that the ethical core of Jewish communities are being picked to pieces by attempting to justify the unjustifiable, or as Michael said, avoiding trying to justify the unjustifiable. That anyone deserves to endure displacement, living in an open air prison, fearing for the lives of their family, or that there's nothing we can do about it, that there's no way to intervene or take action, or that because of past and current communal harm, we have or do support harm. Because of past and current communal harm, we get a pass on the ways that as individuals and in communities, we have or do support harm to other people and to Palestinians specifically. I believe this is a core moral, political, and ethical challenge for the American Jewish community, and for all of us who are working to build a just multiracial democracy here in the US and take responsibility for the harm of our country's moral, political, and financial support for Israeli oppression. We are at a moment of deep reckoning when we can see more and more clearly that the visions of Trump and Netanyahu are both deep articulations of what has always been, and at the same time, a regressive vision of a future that only deepens militarization, dispossession, and xenophobia. In the same time period that the Netanyahu government has barred human rights activists, they are building and deepening alliances with white nationalist movements in the US and far-right movements across the globe. The deep alliance between Trump and Netanyahu reveals a deep disregard for the safety of Jews across the globe and in the US at a moment when the rise of anti-Semitism in the US has been incited and driven by the Trump presidency and the white nationalist movements that brought him to power. On October 6, 2018, 11 elderly Jews were killed in their synagogue in Pittsburgh. May their memories be for a blessing. They were killed because of anti-Semitism, because their congregation supported immigrant justice, and because of rising white nationalism in this country. The same week, two African Americans were killed at a grocery store after a failed attempt by their assassinator to break into a black church. We're seeing a rise of white nationalism in this country that we need to all be concerned about. A few days later, when Trump came to Pittsburgh, progressive Jewish leaders refused to welcome him, and Israeli officials stepped in to welcome him. Let's be excited about that. Let's be excited about that. Yay! Progressive Jewish leaders doing something. Okay, that's good. But the bad news is, right? So then Israeli officials stepped in to welcome him instead. So I think this is like really is illustrating where we're at and a huge moment, a huge opportunity for our organizing of an American Jewish community waking up and being able to talk about and understand anti-Semitism and how it's connected to racism and other forms of oppression. The harm that has been created by defenders of Israeli occupation and aggression by attempting to define criticism of Israel as anti-Semitism is more apparent than ever. Anti-Semitism is bigotry and discrimination against Jews for being Jewish. This can take the form of violence, threats of violence, repeating or circulating anti-Semitic conspiracy theories, or using coded anti-Semitic dog whistling. Israel is a state. It is not a religion. It does not, like it claims, speak for all the Jewish people. And as any other state, it should be held accountable for the policies which deny people access to human rights. Criticism of the Israeli state is not inherently based on the Jewish identity of most Israeli citizens, It's based on the nation state's historical and present actions. And as we can see in this political moment, one can be a Zionist and anti-Semitic. And we have some really concerning examples of that in the Trump era. The biggest threat to American Jews is not BDS activists and those who are critical to Israel. It is, in fact, white nationalists. And in order to effectively fight anti-Semitism, we know that it is part of white supremacy in the United States and must go hand in hand with addressing other forms of racism, just like Michael was saying. We must be committed to addressing anti-Semitism in the context of fighting racism and fighting Islamophobia. Over the past years, at the same time that white nationalism has been on the rise, there have been concrete campaigns by those seeking to maintain the status quo of Israeli actions to make criticism of Israel part of the legal and administrative definitions of anti-Semitism. Palestine Legal has documented over 142 incidents in 2017 of false accusations of anti-Semitism used against Palestinian rights activists. Misuse of the charge of anti-Semitism dilutes the utility of the term. As my sister said to me recently, I wish people just could understand what anti-Semitism is clearly, and for it to not be so confusing, right? And it dilutes the utility of having a term to identify, talk about, and work against discrimination, violence, and hatred towards Jews. Equating furthering of Palestinian rights with anti-Semitism deeply harms Palestinians. It makes those who are already affected by surveillance and policing working for Palestinian rights more vulnerable. It erodes the state of political thought and clarity on the left, and it is also deeply harmful to Jewish communities. So, where does that leave us collectively? Well, first, thinking and talking together, which I'm excited to do more of with you all. And it leaves us with commitments. From education system to Congress, Jewish Voice for Peace is committed to consistently clarifying that criticism of Israel is not a definition of anti-Semitism, and that the BDS movement is rooted in a commitment to equality, to Palestinian equality, and to equality and human rights, full stop. We also commit to fighting anti-Semitism alongside anti-Palestinian racism, anti-Black racism, xenophobia, and white nationalism.
All right, we're gonna open this up to questions and answers. I just wanna say one thing. We have two people recording this, and one of them has a microphone for that recording. So we're going to ask if you have a question to come up here so the microphone can pick up your voice. And Craig is going to coordinate this for us.
Yes, so we're going to be utilizing Progressive Stack for the Q&A portion. Progressive Stack is a form of leading discussions which involves a facilitator, which will be me, keeping a list of names of people who wish to speak. I'll be scanning the room during the discussion. If you wish to speak, you can raise your hand and catch my eye. Because of our audio situation, we'll use a modified version where you can raise your hand. I'll make eye contact with you. If you would like to speak, come up to the front. If you were a town crier in a previous life, if your voice can fill a concert hall, you can stay in your seat. And if you're not able to make it to the front of the room, just raise one finger instead, and I will bring your question to the front. The facilitator will not simply write a list of names in the order that people raise their hand. If someone who hasn't spoken yet, they'll go to the top of the list. If someone who is of an oppressed group raises their hand, they go to the top of the list unless they've already contributed significantly to the discussion. So, yes.
I didn't wait for the rules. Ready? Any other discussion?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. I have 2 points. In 2013, $1.1 billion was donated to UNRWA, which is the Palestinians, of which $294 million was contributed by the United States. My second point is, if you go to Israel, you will find over 100 groups that are working for Israeli-Palestinian peace. One of the wonderful ones, and I happen to know the rabbi, is
one trying to make peace on the ground. Okay, that's my second point.
Hi, my name is Irfan Khawaja. I teach philosophy at Felician University. So thank you all for your presentations, which I really liked. So I have a question that's really kind of a matter of detail about exactly how BDS is supposed to operate kind of on the ground. So I'm an academic, and I teach both here and abroad. I teach at Al-Quds University in Palestine, in Abu Dis. Oh, so I teach both here and at Al-Quds University. And so my question is, I need some guidance about the B part of BDS. That is, as an academic, I get invitations from various institutions to speak. I could, in principle, accept job offers or consider job offers. And I guess I'm just looking for some guidance on how someone should be thinking about this as an individual rather than as a member of an institution.
Is your question addressed to anyone?
It's addressed to anyone who wants to answer it.
Yeah.
So one great resource for academics on these questions is an organization called US ACTI, which is the US Academic Campaign for Boycott. First, just to say, like, ACTI would be a great resource for you. The academic boycott is both intended to be a boycott of institutions. So some of the academic boycotts that we've seen that have been really powerful have included both organizations or individuals within organizations deciding not to have their organizational conferences. In Israel, we've seen organizations that have passed resolutions both supporting BDS and also making other commitments. And so the purpose of the academic boycott is to put pressure on Israeli academic institutions, right? To say Israeli academic institutions need to take a stand against Israeli apartheid. And so that's the point of the pressure. So I can't give you personal advice, but the point is to create pressure, and I think that that's always most successful through a concerted campaign, right? There are many products that we can all boycott, and I think that the best use of our resources, actually, is to get together in groups and organizations and participate in campaigns, but that's where we're the most powerful. But then there are, of course, times when we need to make individual ethical decisions. I can't make them for you, but that's a sort of little bit of a framework.
Hello.
Hi.
My question is, what can each one of us do as an individual? And second, I'd like to know how we can get our government, our legislators, our congressmen and senators who are brought to Israel to also go on the Palestinian side. I saw Palestine, I was in Israel and Palestine, when interfaith organization, and I believe if a person goes and sees what is going on in Palestine, I can't believe that a human being will not change and see the truth and see the injustice and change their mind. And I know that a lot of politicians are brought to Israel. I wonder if they go on the other side. All they have to do is take a few more steps. What are your organizations doing to make sure that we get them to do that, and what can we do as individuals?
I know that the new congresswoman from Michigan is organizing just that. She's going to Palestine.
Rashid Tlaib.
Tlaib.
She's facilitating a group of congressmen and women to come out and bring them to see from a different perspective. So that's the good news, is that moving forward with this new Congress that will be
taking session in early 2019, they're going to be looking to bring some more of the progressive voices and other members of Congress to go see it from the Palestinian perspective for the first time.
Is that a one time? Can we have, do we know of an organization that can make that their goal, so that if three or four go now, how about the next group, the next group? Because that's the way to change how our senators and congressmen feel.
Yeah, I agree 100%.
You got to see to believe it. You cannot go wrong. If you see, you're going to cry.
We have...
should know that because maybe they can contact you. Okay.
Great.
Great.
That's a great idea.
So my name is Lily, and obviously I'm not from the Middle East and not from the region, but just very interested in learning from you and what we could do. One of the things that I have heard Mandela actually said at one point about the BDS movement in South Africa. He actually said that he understood what sacrifices the local people will have to make deep and long before BDS would actually take effect. Because the first thing that it's going to hurt are the very people that their livelihood, which is already so squeezed. I'm completely in support of BDS. I think that for us as individual consumers, for us to say, oh, I'm not going to buy tomatoes that are clearly listed as from Israel, yes, do that, but that is not powerful enough. I would like to get also guidance from the panel as to what can we do collectively that would make sense. I am alum of UC Berkeley. I was appalled that UC Berkeley turned down the BDS the divestment. Even Berkeley, what I considered to be a liberal campus, turned it down. What can we do? I mean, I, as an alum, I can write to the university, but one voice is not enough. How can we organize individual consumers, individual alums, individual students, etc.? When we write to corporation to say divest, the same thing happened. One voice is not enough. And the other thing is they have to feel the ramifications of their refusal to divest. How can we make them feel the hurt and the pain? Which also goes back to my earlier question. The first question is, I know that the local people in Palestine, in Israel, are going to suffer first before the politicians would actually budge. How deep and how long are we asking them to sacrifice?
I'll go back on it.
Well, I could say that, as you could see from when the movement first started in the mid-2000s up until now, we've seen tremendous change. Even specifically from when I was in college, the movement was just starting to really pick up steam, to now when I'm seeing constantly, every few weeks, I'm seeing constant new updates on companies that are walking away from decisions that they have made because of pressure. And the one that I think of as most notable is Airbnb. We're talking about an enormous corporation that has business throughout the world. If they were able to be brought down to their knees and shown that what they're doing is wrong, it shows that other corporations are also going to take effect as well. The problem is, as you said, it's not just one voice. Unfortunately, I think that the best option for it would be that it's continued pressure. It may not happen overnight, but it's to continue to tell your friends, your family, your loved ones, your neighbors, people you don't even know very well, but to explain to them exactly what's going on and to educate them on exactly what the BDS movement stands for. Because that's a main issue, is that there is a lot of misconceptions regarding the movement. So I think with continued outreach and continued support amongst the community, and not just, the other thing that I have to highlight specifically, this is one thing that I always brought up at school, is that it's one thing to communicate amongst each other. All of us agree, we may agree on the same point, that this movement is the way that brings change. But the only way to bring that change is not by being in the minority only affecting that change. We need to go to everybody and make it vocal to people who may not even have that much invested into the cause, but can understand from sitting in the back that it's what's going on is wrong. And to make it known that the policies that are being implemented in Israel and in the occupied territories are discriminatory and are forms of apartheid. And I think just with continued knowledge and education is really going to be the best way, because without that, there's going to be a lot of difficulties in achieving what exactly we want. It's education, education, education. That's the best way, I would say.
Can I jump on to that?
Yeah, sure.
I agree with that 100%, and I also think that on your point of like what one person can do, I completely agree with talking to your community. And I think that, you know, if we're trying to make political change, we need to be connected to political mm-hmm. communities that are making change together. And so I think that whether you're part of a neighborhood association, a PTA, an alum association, a religious community, I think actually bringing this conversation into whatever political communities or other communities you are a part of and asking them that question. Asking them the question, what can we do together to support the BDS movement for Palestinian freedom? Universities, alum associations, students are always needing more support, right? So if you're part of an alum association, that's a great way to go. The churches in this country have actually really led the way, mainstream Protestant churches, in supporting BDS. If you're part of a denomination, a religious denomination that has not done that, that's a great place to start the conversation. But I do really think that bringing the question of how can we support a boycott campaign, how can we support divestment to whatever political communities we are part of, having maybe the same conversation and then organizing some next steps is the way that
can I just add?
Oh, I'm so sorry, Michael. No,
this
go.
This won't take long. No, I have to say, this is a question that always makes me uncomfortable. I'm not good at answering it. I'm not an organizational person. I'm certainly not a politician. I'm a writer, and that's a notoriously isolated and isolating kind of vocation. But I will say this. We cannot act just as individuals if we're going to make political change. We have to try to take advantage of any group, any organization, anything, any community that we are part of to make it a communal and joint endeavor. I don't know about you, but I receive several requests from Jewish organizations every week for money. They're always appealing to me for one contribution or another. And I've started to make it almost a ritual now. I will respond to them by saying, tell me first what you're doing about the occupation. If they want my money, they want to be part of this community for that purpose, then I want to know what they're doing for our community about a criminal state that is debasing our religion every day. And I want to get other people embarrassed about that, then maybe whole groups of us will start to complain, and then what happened to the Airbnb might happen with the Jewish federations, and that may sound like a pie-in-the-sky dream. But that's how we have to do it. We can't just do it. We can't just take wrong.
Directed to Mr. Amin.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a veteran of I'm a veteran movement. I'm a former member of the Black Panther Party. And one of our first boycotts was with Cesar Chavez and the grape and lettuce settlement. You know, we fought against Safeway in California, and we fought against supermarkets on the East Coast. But the point is that the Farm Workers Union was basically a Filipino and Palestinian union at first. The Palestinian people built that union up and included the Mexican-American citizens. The thing is that, you know, I see the BD BDS movement more as a social media thing. It's like a Black Lives Matter type thing. But physically, we get those citizens of Clifton to get in front of these supermarkets and actually point out which products the Israeli government sends over here. Because I tell you, I go into the Asian markets and I see Israeli oranges and the whole shebang. Nobody has any information about what products. Sabra, you know, and I think that, you know, good old mimeograph paper and hand leaflets work a lot better than social media.
Yeah. What I could say in this regard, and I think it also goes back to education and educating the community, educating the people that you are around constantly, because in this day and age, it definitely is difficult. From my perspective, I've had a lot of difficulties, and especially in organizing in college and the such, is that to get a lot of people, the main issue that I have is getting a lot of people out to advocate for these causes with the fear that they may be held accountable for it. The one thing that I think that is somewhat different compared to movements in the past is the greatness that comes with social media. There's also a lot of negativity and a lot of issues. And a lot of people that I know that are not Palestinian and are not somewhat connected to the movement, where they're not really worried about what to lose, they're worried to jump in because of, you know, organizations, for example, like Canary Mission, that has dozens of my friends on it and lists them as terror sympathizers and terror financiers. So I think the main thing is to get into the mainstream, make it well known that just because you support these types of movements does not necessarily mean that you are anti-Semitic. Does not mean that you are anti-Jewish or you have any type of hatred or bigotry. It's to, again, continue to advocate amongst your groups, amongst your communities, amongst, you know, even little simple federations that you may have with friends and loved ones, and just to continue to bring out that outreach. And I do agree that a physical presence in certain circumstances is necessary. And specifically, the one thing that really got me angered recently was what happened at CNN with Mark Lamont Hill. And I believed, personally, right away, the first thing that I thought is, like, people need to go out and they need to protest CNN. You know, the only way there's going to be some type of change is people go stand outside of CNN headquarters, the same way that there were hundreds of protesters protesting against the Trump administration outside of Trump Towers. If we can organize as a community to be outside of these locations, that can bring extreme change. But the problem is that we need to come in numbers. It can't just be 5-6 people on the sidelines, because at the end of the day, it doesn't bring that national attention that's necessary. So to bring that type of attention that we want, we need to go out there in large groups and show that it's not just a minority of people that are standing by these movements, that it's a very large amount of the community that is behind it. And I mean, in New York, in northern New Jersey, in California, in a lot of these liberal areas, it's possible. But it definitely will take a lot of help from not just the Jewish community or not just from the Palestinian community. We need to pull together groups of people who are willing to work together and facilitate this change. And I honestly, I strongly do believe in this physical presence, and I would love to work on that end. It's just, I've had difficulties organizing to get the amount of people to turn out for these organizations. And I know that it definitely takes time, it's not something that could happen overnight, but if there's anything that I could recommend is that if you guys have the ability to attend something, some type of protest or some type of event, it definitely brings change. Because from my personal experience, when I was in court for my case against Fordham, the courtroom was so packed with supporters that there was not enough seats. They had the hallway of the courtroom was filled with people trying to get into, trying to see what's going on, just to show their support of what was happening to me. And that honestly brought so much national attention to my case. And that's what brought, you know, all these types of organizations, for example, Democracy Now! Reached out to me then. It's like, oh, hey, can you come and speak to our audience base about what's going on? It would never have happened if it wasn't for the vast amount of community
and just support from throughout the area that came out to speak in my behalf. So when we come out in droves and we come out to support, that's when change happens. We see what happened with the Women's March in Washington, D.C. after Trump was elected. Look at the amount of people that came out. Look at the Me Too movement. Look at the amount of people that are actually now speaking out that wouldn't have spoke out prior because they were worried. They were scared. They knew that they may be, you know, outcasted for speaking out against these certain practices and these sexual harassment claims and all these issues that have been around for decades. You know, it's not new news. But once we all came out in together and supported each other, that's when the changes happened. I was reading about yesterday, one of these heads of CNN, of CBS, the founder of 60 Minutes, there were a number of claims that were against him for sexual harassment, that he ruined women's careers in the 80s and 90s. And this just kind of got brushed under the rug. No one brought it up. There was some settlement. And this now all came out 25 years later because of the movement. So when we can all come together and work together, then we're going to have some real change. I can guarantee that.
I have 20 seconds. There is a sense of powerlessness and a continuing sense of lack of coordination within the larger, I'm going to call it, left movement. And I just want you to know that in January, there is a group of people in New York City who will be meeting to try to form us into a coalition, a movement that will support each other's activities. It's just getting started, but I just wanted people to know that that is, it's going to happen. It's important.
Good. Is that what Sanders?
My name is Patricia Allison Greeney. I belong to the Green Party in Brooklyn County. We have had forums with Norman Finkelstein that drew a very large crowd. Also with Jeff Halper. He does this marvelous work in Israel. It's the Jewish, it's the Israeli Committee Against House Demolitions, and that was packed. And we were able to raise $900 at that time for his organization. And he's just marvelous. He's still working, and I'm on their email list and so on. Anyway, what I wanted to say was, maybe some of you already know this. I don't remember which website, because I'm on so many, whether it was Arabs in Support of Palestine. But there's a bill before Congress, and it's part of the budget bill. It's probably hidden way down in the bottom. To support, to outlaw corporations who do business in Israel. Now, there was a number to call. I called Nancy Pelosi's office and asked her not to vote for that budget. But I'm not sure how many people would be, her number was, I can't remember the website, I'm sorry, but you can get her number or her website or her email address to ask her not to vote for this, because they often sneak a little something horrible in these bills. And do they read these bills? They have their aides read these bills. They're too long. So I thank you, and thank you very much for this.
Thank you.
And just one note on that. One of the lead supporters of this bill and this anti-boycott bill is actually our Senator Cory Booker. He's supposed extreme praise towards these type of these bills. So we have the ability to bring change. He's our senator. We elected him, you know, and he acts as though he's a social justice warrior. But then when it comes to the rights of Palestinians, he backs away. So I think that it's especially important for us as a New Jersey community, if there's one person to reach out to specifically, start bombarding his office. Start sending him letters. Start contacting him. Have your wife, your husband, your daughter, your son, just bombard them, you know? And make it known that there's his constituents are against it. You vote for this, we will vote you out in the next election. Make it very obvious to him.
Thank you.
Yep.
My name is Madeline Hoffman. I'm with the Green Party of New Jersey. And I wanted to speak right now because of what you just said about Senator Cory Booker. Because there was a delegation of us, maybe six or seven of us, who met with him just this past Tuesday. And while he claims to be, or his aides actually, not him, claim to be concerned about Palestinian rights and doing more for Palestinian rights than just about anybody, he stands extremely firmly against BDS. He said, his aide said, it's an area on which we're going to agree to disagree. He's immovable on BDS. He's also not going to budge off right now his support for either the bill that Pat Alessandrini talked about, or the one, the other one about stifling student dissent. He's not, they weren't 100% sure on. He said he thought, the aide said that he thought that all of the free speech and civil rights, civil liberties concerns had already been addressed by the revision. So we have an uphill battle with Senator Booker. I'm not saying we shouldn't do it, we shouldn't tackle it, but I wanted everybody in this room to know just how entrenched he is on that issue. And with his political aspirations for president, it's gonna take a lot of moving to move him off that. And I think I agree wholeheartedly we have to do it, but we need to know where we stand. He does think that it's anti-Semitic. He does think that it's not a proper tactic to use. And all of us, I think we were extremely persuasive in our arguments, but the aide would not budge. So just
we should all call tomorrow.
Yeah.
And on that note is also on protesting at CNN. There was a protest there. I would say let's have a protest the first Saturday of every month. And so people know and expect that it's gonna happen. And every Saturday, first Saturday of every month, more people go. And the same thing with Senator Booker. Maybe we organize some vigil there the second Saturday of every month. But whatever it is, it's gotta be persistent and consistent.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I wanted to say.
Consistency
is
key, definitely.
Thank you, Matt.
Tomorrow and every day after tomorrow.
And also on that, the state director who we met with, Booker's state director, said Cory Booker has always been against BDS. He is against BDS. He will always be against BDS.
If we could just limit the comments.
So he's not.
So I completely agree. You should all call as many times as you can, and maybe the New Jersey chapter or any other organizations can, if you haven't already, you probably have resend around the action alert that has been put out to put that pressure on. And I just wanted to say that JVP has only been engaged in congressional advocacy for about 4 or 5 years. Before that point, we were sort of like, they're not gonna listen to us. US policy is firmly pro-Israel, what can we do? So we've been building slowly, and the New Jersey chapter has been active. Central New Jersey has as well. I know that you all have locally built a lot of powerful coalitions, and I think that's really what's needed to take on the Senate. And I just want to say that a thing that we learned in about the last year was that the relationship building, meeting with the officers, calling, that's really key and important and necessary. And the place where the most pressure can be placed is town halls, public appearances, and places where a progressive constituency is gathered. Because a progressive constituency, whether they've heard about Israel-Palestine at all, does not want to hear that their representatives are going against free speech. And the ACLU is very clearly against 720. It's very clearly against the Silencing Students Act. That is something you can be very clear about. So I think that just for future organizing, that's a place to be really looking for, is those public progressive spaces where you're actually going to be able to embarrass people, because it's embarrassing that they are going against free speech. challenge. The fact that they're not supporting BDS, unfortunately, we're working on that, right? But most of Congress doesn't support BDS. Even people who have moved forward the first ever bill on Palestinian rights, which is looking to address U.S. Like funding and support for the detention of Palestinian children. Even some of the strongest supporters of those legislation walk into their offices, they say, you know, we'll see what happens to the new Congress, but they say, don't ask me to support BDS, right? That's sort of, unfortunately, that's where the status quo is in Congress. So I think we just sort of need to know that, know sort of where for them the status quo is, and know where are the points that we can push them. And on this legislation, I feel like it's a huge important way to educate the broader progressive community about the BDS movement, about what's happening in Palestine, and the place where we have pressure to embarrass the politicians. I think free speech is one of the places we need to be pushing.
I'll try to elaborate here. My name is Carl Schwartz. I'm from the International Socialist Organization. We're a group that enthusiastically endorsed BDS pretty early on in its existence. And my question was, when I was 19, actually, I went on a Birthright trip. And since then, I've been trying to unlearn a lot of the propaganda that was given to me on that trip. And I'm really curious if anybody on the panel has got to talk to any of the students who have done the Birthright walkouts recently. I think it's super inspiring. And I know when I was 19 and I went on that trip, I was nowhere near brave enough to do something like that, so I think those kids deserve mad props for that. And I also had another question, too. I think most people become aware of this Palestinian liberation issue on college campuses. That was definitely where I started learning about it. And I think it's kind of sad that it took me that long, and it's a reflection of the sorry state of the history classes I had in high school.
Better late than never.
And how, when I was learning about world history in high school, it was taught as like this equal conflict between two religious groups. And I mean, I got absolutely none of the real education of what happened. I didn't know about the Nakba till well into college, or any of these issues. I just want to know if it's possible, like, are there any efforts among high school teachers across the country to really give a more accurate curriculum and overview of the history and creation of Israel?
There are actually, Jewish Voice for Peace has a Return the Birthright campaign. If Not Now is doing these walkouts and has a campaign against Birthright. And Open Hillel also has some type of Birthright campaign. So we're really in a moment where I think basically sort of all of the Jewish left pro-Palestine in some way organizations are focusing on Birthright, and I think it is really exciting. Some resources, whether you're unlearning sort of at age 18 or unlearning at age 65, I think it's really important. JVP has a Facing the Nakba curriculum, which was designed specifically for learning in Jewish communities about the Nakba and for sort of saying that the Nakba is a part of Jewish history that we need to learn about. It's not the only resource, but you can find it at jvp.org. And it was, I think it sort of did get in the mix of one of these, at least for progressive educators, resources that are available to them. And I think that there is a lot of work to do, and I think it points to your question, points to the fact that, right, this is an issue within the Jewish community. This is also an issue within all of our communities, right? This is how the U.S. is positioning and talking about Palestine, that, you know, that there can be any equality, and that's something that we really need to challenge in all of our own work.
We have time for one more question, so I'm going to combine two. Just if you could go into greater detail about coalition building, how we avoid starting from scratch, and when there are other groups that don't agree with us, like Invisible, let's reach out to, and did not respond positively, how do we avoid those issues with coalition building?
Can you repeat the second part of the question?
When groups don't respond positively to our efforts at coalition building, how do we work around that?
Can I speak to that? Because I was one of the people who raised that as a question.
when we were doing, my name's John, I'm a member of JVP, I also live in Bergen County. And in doing outreach for this meeting, one of the places that we reached out to were some people who were with Indivisible Bergen, but I assume this may be true with other Indivisibles as well. And we got a very negative response about, you know, coming. And when you look on their website, it turns out that people like Loretta Weinberg, who is a prime example of progressive except on Palestine, you know, is a major figure in that. And I actually raised it because I think that as we were talking about places to reach out, that a place like Indivisible, for example, and also I'm involved in some of the work in supporting immigrants, where obviously there are both Jews and non-Jews involved. But that when people were saying, bring this to every group you're involved with, I think that we need to do that. And speaking to Indivisible in particular, there's no reason, I mean, obviously there were very good results around the election and Indivisible groups did a lot of good work. There's no reason for us to cede the control of these groups to people who are on the wrong side in terms of Palestine. So anybody who's involved in that should actively push. So it wasn't a question so much of how do we deal with it in coalition building as it was, let's be upfront and just keep pushing and put them on the defensive.
I raised the other half of that question, which is more optimistic and encouraging. When I think back to how the civil rights movement was built, it wasn't that there was this lone person on the bus got fired being the back. She was an activist for many years, but it was an organization that built that. There were organizations that built the anti-war movement. Every movement that you know about, even if you don't know much about it, they were fed and built by organizations that were in motion, by people who are willing to stand forth and be counted. And there are people like that. I'm very encouraged to see BSA, the Democratic Socialist of America, co-sponsor this. They're 60,000 strong. Okay, that's mainly young people. They mainly don't want to listen to old people like me, which is fine. But there's an energy there. There are people who are in motion. And if you can get groups like that, none of them are as big as BSA, to call out their members, you can have 1,000 people in the streets tomorrow. You're not getting 2 people. We don't have to do this retail. We don't have to find the bold, heroic individual. There's a mass movement out there already that's susceptible to us in a fair motion. And we need to find and encourage that. It's great to go to the DPA, but good luck, okay? We need to be selective, and we need to be optimistic. We need that revolutionary optimism.
Short response to that. You know, I would just urge everybody in this process not to write off groups because they seem to be hostile. I can tell you about my own group. I'm an Orthodox Jew. Orthodox Judaism was very cool to Zionism for decades. It was not interested in the Zionist movement, which it saw as a rejection and repudiation of Judaism. It's only in very recent years that so many Orthodox Jews have become almost fanatically supportive of Israel, and has to do with fear and religious culture rather than religion. That can change. The entire American Jewish community, people don't believe this today, but it's easy to document, there's very little support for Israel in the American Jewish community before 1967. I'm old enough to remember 1967. Before that, nobody talked about Israel. So there were exceptions, but as a community, it wasn't there. When political changes happen, people will change with it. I know that there are Orthodox Jews who are critical of Israel. I know that because there are secret groups of them. They don't want to speak out, but they exist. And when the opportunity comes, you can have more of a movement than you might think from the initial response. So don't give up on these on various groups just because they don't give you initial positive response.
I agree. Yeah. And I agree. There's a lot happening. And in the next few months, I think what we need is an organization, an umbrella group that will somehow bring together all of these similarly thinking organizations and some that are not. We have to approach people who don't agree with us.
Yes.
We can't constantly be preaching to the choir. This is great. I mean, this is a great turnout. I thank you all. I think you were absolutely wonderful. Be sure you put your name
on our mailing list that's out there if you haven't, and look at the literature, and especially Michael's literature is out there. It's fantastic. Anybody else want to just wrap this up?
Sure. If you want to stay in contact with BSA, we have a sign-up list outside. We also have a lot of zines about BDS, eco-socialism, queer liberation, all that.
And also on the back of the papers that you had on your seat, there's information about things that you can do, what's new here. We also have this what may be hopeless campaign in this book. There are also postcards on the refreshment table that you can take to send.
You guys are wonderful.
All right.